The Bothell City Council is now back from executive session. What we did in executive session was discussed the candidates for the city manager position and what we're going to do now using letters, because the candidates are all still confidential. We can't give out their names yet. Some of them have jobs, that type of thing. So what we're going to do is use letters for each individual. We, all of us, know which letter is which individual. So that's, we made sure that everybody knew that. So we are going to fill out a ballot, basically listing our top six out of the 10 candidates that we would like to invite back for a interview. So we're going to fill those out now, and then we're going to do a little bit more with the hiring process in open session here to discuss the panelists for the different boards that are going to interview the candidates. And we're also going to discuss the travel expenses and whether or not the city will pay for the travel expenses for out-of-state candidates. So council members, please fill out your ballots. And if anybody has anything they'd like to say in encouraging other council members to select a specific candidate, please use the letter that we assign them in executive session. Councilmember Freed.
I just had a clarity and curiosity. Are we writing our names on the ballot?
I don't see why not.
You don't have to, but you can if you want.
Okay, I will.
Okay.
Deputy Mayor.
So we had a conversation about, a couple things were brought up about Mr. E. And I just wanted to advocate, I'd at least like to meet this individual. They talk about working in a community with a historic downtown, tackling growth and parking issues. I think this person talks about environmental stewardship, and I would like the opportunity to at least meet this person. I think whatever reservations people have might go away when they meet them, because we're only looking at letters and words on paper. So I liked a lot of what this person had to say, and I guess I'll leave it at that.
Great. Does anybody else have any comments they want to throw towards one candidate or the other? Councilmember Freed?
Yeah, for me, I won't use a letter or a person's name, but for me, what I was looking at as far as analysis is looking at candidates that have around the same population that they've managed at some form or fashion or greater. And certainly, I think what is important to the city of Bothell is somebody that's personable with us and with the city. And I think we have a very strong finance department. So somebody that would have really personal and organizational experience we have 44,000 people in the city of Bothell. So somebody who's been involved with a city of that size or greater is important to me. But appreciate the good discussion.
Councilmember Sandberg.
Well, I had some strong favorites. There were some people who were at the top of my list. Candidate H, I think, has a variety of experience with cities of varying sizes and executive level responsibility currently. And I think that's really important, because that hits on so many of the criteria that we're looking for. I was looking at someone who had experience with IT system overhaul. That was one of our criteria. Strategic planning experience, strong financial background, and economic development. And I think this candidate hits on that. I saw that also with candidate D was also a top choice. Candidate J. And then there were some others that I hadn't in our conversation, I thought I would like to have them come in and so we could understand them, those individuals, a little bit better. Candidate C, so I'd like to hear more from candidate C. And Well, Let me figure that out and get back to you.
Okay. Councilmember Spivey.
Great, thank you. Like Councilmember Freed, I'm not going to necessarily, I may or may not bring up candidate letters at this time, but I too was looking at parity and city and staff size, as well as like issues that they've dealt with in their previous job history, as to similar issues that we have here, economic development, in those types of things. So that those are the candidates that came up. The candidates I have listed here are the ones that I thought were stronger in those areas. I thought it was important that, as was mentioned, the working with similar sized cities and population base and FTEs, those were important. I also, like Councilmember Sandberg pointed out, I did look at the technology side a bit as well, because we are going to have to be working forward on our technology. But I just looked at overall the things that we're addressing, and have they addressed them in one way or another, or are they currently addressing them? And that played a role in how I chose my candidates also.
Great. Any other councils want to chime in? All right, Councilmember Agnew.
Yeah, I chose basically mine similar to the rest of the council members. I looked at the city sizes. I looked at their education. I looked at their experiences. We have a wonderful opportunity here to make a huge change in this city, and I think a lot of these candidates are very, very qualified candidates. So I want to thank Mr. Slavin for bringing them to our attention, and I'm looking forward to the rest of the process.
The sole council member. Okay. So we had 38 candidates. I thought that's kind of interesting to know. And now we had 10 that we were asked to review as a council. And anybody that made this list of 10 is basically a highly qualified candidate. Some of the things that I was really looking for was kind of more of the, like, putting the qualifications aside, looking for more of a personal touch, how they communicate in their letter to us, how they answered the questions, that type of thing. Are they confusing? Do they drag on and on, or do they get concise, precise answers? One of the things I really looked for too was to a mix of, as a city manager, you speak to what you have done as a city, and then as well as what you do individually. And so I looked at that a lot with the candidates to see, if they're taking credit for things that, they could or could not have done individually, or if it really applies to them in general. A lot of the candidates, it was interesting because they talked about the city that they're a part of, but, what did they actually really do was something I was trying to mine out of these resumes and questionnaires. Like always, I've been through a lot of hiring processes, and it's hard to tell on paper. It really is which candidates are the best, but there's definitely some of these that rose to the top in my opinion compared to the others. So that's what I have to add. Has everybody got theirs filled out? And we'll hand them down to the clerk. So while that's being tallied up, so there's a few different panels that'll interview the city manager candidates, and one of them will be a panelist of employees. And what we would like to do, what was proposed by the city manager, is that he would present to the council a list of employees, up to maybe 10 different people that will be part of that panel that'll interview each of the city managers. Candidates. And so is there any discourse or agreement to having the interim city manager create the list, and then we communicate about that at our next council meeting? Councilmember Freed.
I would be in favor of having the heads of each department sit on the interview panel. So police chief, fire chief, parks director, finance director. I think that'd be the right way to go. So that's my vote.
So, City Manager, can you elaborate on how you were going to select people for the employee panel?
Well, my only concern, we have 10 departments, and I'd like to keep the panel to about 10 maximum. I would like to include a cross-section of the different union groups as well, and then to get some mid-management and general line employees. So if I do, then we're going to add 20. That's too many. So what I'd like to do is get, maybe have the leadership team itself pick who from the senior team will represent the department directors, and then fill in the rest of, you know, maybe 5 from the departments, and then the rest from the rest of the organization. That's kind of what I was thinking. I just to make it manageable, because I don't want 20.
I wasn't suggesting 20. I was suggesting actually 10, which would actually be 9, because we wouldn't have a representative from the city manager department or executive department.
Oh, and not include the others, yeah. Well, my intent would be to give you more of a cross-section of the organization. So.
And my assumption is the directors know their organization well and their employees and what they're looking for. So since those directors would ultimately be working under the new city manager, I thought that would be a healthy situation for them to understand who that might be and who they would see as a good leader that they could appreciate to fall under. So that's my perspective.
Where they would nominate someone to represent their department, or they would be the one?
Well, they would be the one. If they're not able to make it, then they certainly could have
the
option to nominate
somebody. Let me give you two lists next week, I guess. Mm-hmm. One that would be just a senior leadership team at 9 or 10, and then
Let's have other council members weigh in on it. Does that sound good? Because okay. We have just heard one opinion. And so before we make a bunch of work out of it, does anybody else have an opinion? Councilmember Sandberg?
I'm comfortable with the interim city manager proposing a staff interview list for our perusal. But I prefer a cross-section of employees. I think we can have a combination of department heads and other employees. I think that's important, because this individual does not just interact with their executive team. We want them and we expect them to interact with the entire employee group. So I think it's important to have a cross-section.
Okay, we got two opinions. Is there anybody else?
I agree with Councilmember Sandberg, and I agree that we need to make sure that we have a cross-section of the organization. So.
Okay. Is there any other input? Deputy Mayor?
I agree with Councilmember Sandberg and Councilmember McNeil. I think it's important to have more than just the executive or the high-level directors weigh in.
Well, that's 3. Here we go. Councilmember Agnew.
I'm fairly comfortable with the interim city manager making that decision, and I'm sure he's going to come up with an adequate staff.
There you go. Okay. Councilmember Spivey?
Yeah, I'm comfortable with the interim city manager. It just, I would like at least one member of each of the represented groups to be part of that. To say a cross-section of them, they have very different very different jobs and all, so I think they all need to be represented. One member from each of our bargaining groups, I think it would be appropriate for that also.
So from the, well, obviously not the management level then. It would be the line staff that are in each of the different bargaining units. Okay, that's a great.
So let me come back to you with a mix.
Okay.
And see if I hit it.
All right. So moving on to the public panelists. So there's a couple of different ways we can do that. We could have each of us just pick somebody, and then there'll only be 7 of them. If we do 10, that gets a little messier. We could have it that each panelist that's from the public has to be somebody that gets 4 votes from the council. There's different ways we could do it, so I'm open to hear what people would like to do. Deputy Mayor?
I would suggest we each get to pick one. I don't care if we vote, that's fine. But I also wanted to suggest that we have some representation from the various boards, the Landmark Board, Planning Commission, Parks Board. Their citizens and their stakeholders. And so I think it would be important to have them also be on the citizen panel.
Okay, that's one opinion. Anybody else?
Mayor?
Like to weigh in?
I would be comfortable with one council member with a name, and then 3 members from our, you know, bringing the total to 10. those other three positions being different board and commission members, that I'm comfortable with, you know, making nominations here, and we just vote on three members from our different boards and commissions. And we probably do that part at our next meeting, I would suggest.
Okay, and so you're a lot like hers, but we pick within the whole board, not just the chair. Is that the difference?
Well, I think that, you know, maybe just make a nomination of different board and commission members. Okay. And go about it that way. And that probably be most appropriate so that we can, you know, reach out, see who may be interested, and all, and do that at our next meeting.
Okay. Is it just the three boards is the same as deputy mayor?
No, I'm just saying just three positions out of all of our different boards and commissions.
Okay.
Mr. Mayor.
To round it up to 10.
Yes.
I have no problem with the numbers or however you get there. My concern is logistics. The interviews are going to be the 18th and 19th. We haven't invited any of the community panel members to be there. If we wait until, the 6th of November, we may not get the people you want. I mean, so if there's a way to get there this evening on who you want, then I can invite them tomorrow. If we wait another week, we might lose some of them. That's my
suggestion was the set our seven choices tonight, and then the boards and commissions would be next week. That's the best I could do.
Does that sound good? Does that sound good? And do anybody else have a flavor or change? Okay, Councilmember Sandberg.
No flavor. It's just I'm not ready to suggest a person that I would like to choose from, you know, from my one choice. And for in terms of picking from the other boards and commissions, are we going to send out an email to all the boards and commissions letting them know this opportunity, what the time constraints are, and then asking people who are interested to respond?
I think we could do that.
If you want to wait till next week, we have time to do that.
I'm ready. I've got my horse all picked out and everything. I'm ready to go tonight for my one pick, but the three, I could probably wing it on the three tonight too, but we could wait. I guess we could wait for that till next week, but they might not be available like the interim city manager brought up. So, Councilmember McNeil.
How many boards and commissions are you referring to, Deputy Mayor?
All of them. There's
parks, planning commission, parks, and landmarks.
Landmark, and then yeah. Library. Civil Service Commission? Is that?
Well, then do you, how far do you go? Do you go then to the library, to the civil service, to the others? I mean, your main ones are, you know, parks and planning.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so I'm not ready tonight either for going all. I'm not ready to go with my one person tonight. I was actually going to waive to allow, if we only had four boards and commissions, I was going to waive mine to go with somebody on one of those commissions, because I don't know if the person that I was going to invite will be able to make it. So I was going to waive it to just make sure that we had the four boards and commissions. But if we're going all the way down the line, I don't know how many that means. So.
All right, I knew this would be fun.
Can I just make a suggestion? Can't we just pick the three main boards, the Planning Commission, Landmark, and Parks, and just have the chair be the person? Or if the chair can't, they can figure it out themselves. I think we're overcomplicating things. I really do.
I don't think we're overcomplicating if we're relegating library and all the other boards to some kind of second tier. And these are all people that are obviously demonstrating an interest in serving the community because they applied and they work in those positions. So I'm more of a egalitarian type person.
Councilmember Fried?
I certainly could make my own choice from any one of the boards that are within the city, as each one of us could. I don't know why we would need to have 10 board members. I think that each one of us on this council should have the opportunity to choose one citizen to be on that board. If that citizen falls off for a family matter the day before, we should be able to choose a new person to appoint that could make it to the next day. So I think we all have that opportunity. We've been elected and represented certain members of the community or the whole community. We can certainly, each one of us, wisely choose one person.
So with the complexity of the discussion, I actually fully agree with Councilmember Freed that I think we should just have seven and each of us pick one, and we're responsible for that person to be notified and selected and available to be on the community panel. Does that sound okay? So we can move on with our day, evening? Okay. Sorry. I mean, it just seems like it's too complicated right now to try to figure this out at the 11th hour.
Are we announcing that tonight, or?
I'm ready to say who I'd like to have be on the public committee if everybody else is, or you're not ready?
Well, just as long as you tell me by tomorrow, because then we can, the idea is to get them invited.
Okay. So I would like a gentleman named Stuart Hill to be my public, on the public committee. I'll get you his phone number off the, dais here, but, and he is available. Councilman Ragney?
I'd like Hugh Moog.
Deputy Mayor?
Pat Parkhurst.
Go ahead, Customer Spivey.
Lee Henderson.
Anybody else have their person picked out yet?
Yeah, I do. Mark Lamb.
You said Hugh. All right. And the other two, you guys don't want to wait?
Yes.
Okay. So I was trying to drag this out so we can get our tally in. I don't see the, they're not done with their ballots. So we can probably move on and come back, I suppose.
Yep, exactly.
Oh, yeah, that's right. So we were asked to discuss at the dais what we want to do about travel expenses. Some people are coming from out of state. One option would be, obviously, to pay for all of their travel expenses. Another option would be to pay for them and their significant other travel expenses to come here and stay in Bothell for the two nights, is it, in 3 days?
Well, probably three, because we've got interviews all day. We've got tours and some staff interviews all day on Friday, and then the formal interviews on Saturday. So we need them here Thursday evening. Obviously, local folks won't need to stay local, you know, Thursday, but we need them here Friday and Saturday. So I think it would be three nights, up to three nights.
And should we, if people are local, should we extend that offer to them to stay in a hotel
here?
I
would think so. You know, it depends. With commute, I know what that can be like to make it on time. So, you know, I think they can pick their options. Some of the candidates live very close.
Okay. Does anybody have an opinion on whether or not we should pay for travel expenses, and especially for people that are nearby? Councilman Ragney.
I think we should pay for the travel expenses for the candidate and the significant other of the candidate. And I'll even go as far as to say we should put them up at McMenamin's. It's the cornerstone of our town. It's the one we love so much.
Okay. Is there any other input on travel expenses?
I would agree with Councilmember Agnew.
Sandberg?
I would agree. I think it's important to, if we have some of our out-of-town candidates, who are some excellent out-of-town candidates, I think it's important to bring them in and make it attractive for them to come interview here. And and I would also like to say we have many fine hotels in Bothell.
Any opinion on this side? Deputy Mayor?
I agree. Bring them in. We need to meet them and I think the spouses, it would be helpful to meet their spouses as well.
Councilmember Spivey.
I support bringing in candidates.
Good. Councilmember Freed.
The question is candidates and spouses. Certainly, I support candidates. I don't know that we need to spend the expenditure for the spouse, though I like that idea. Typically in the executive world, you would invite them for the second interview, would have the spouse come as well. But if the majority of the council wants to support bringing them all at one point, then I guess that's where we're at. So I'm just for the candidate at this point.
Okay. Got what you need? Okay. We're still waiting for the ballots. So we could try to do some public comment.
Mr. Mayor, a couple updates on the agenda. Have you done the agenda updates yet?
We could take up the couple of ad hoc things that we added a couple items to the agenda tonight.
In the second exec session that's later this evening, just they added the reference, but we need some discussion on real property as well, which would be section 4230.110.1c. So that would be in the second exec session. And yeah, I think those were the agenda updates, although I think Councilmember Freed wanted to raise an issue.
Yep, we got that on the agenda. Yep. So our HR director, go ahead, come up to the podium here and give us the news.
So Mayor Council, the tally was very, very close. So I would say it was near unanimous on the sixth. So I'll just read the letters in no order of vote. Candidate A, candidate D, candidate F, candidate H, candidate I, and candidate J. That should be six.
It is. Great. Thank you, sir.
One quick comment, Mr. Mayor. I don't think you made this comment yet, but it's awkward with the exec session rules and all that, but our intent would be to now have Mr. Slavin contact each of these six, verify that, in fact, they are finalists and are ready to have their names released to the public. And then as soon as Bob Slavin's done that, then we would make the names and their resumes and backgrounds public. So our intent's to be very public with this, but we didn't want to do it and not give them an opportunity to talk to their councils before those names are released.
And the names will be released within the next week or so, from what I understand.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Great. Thank you for going through that with us. So we are on to the consent agenda, but we did have one item pulled. Do we have a motion to move through the remainder of the consent agenda with pulling AB 16-179?
So moved.
Moved by Deputy Mayor, seconded by Councilmember McNeil. Go ahead, place your vote. Passes unanimously. AB 16-179, approval of the 2017 legislative priorities. Councilmember Sandberg, I believe you pulled this. You have the floor.
Yes, thank you. So I apologize for missing the original discussion on this. And I just had a couple format and then a substance comment. And so I think it's great that from the original draft, a lot of the wordiness has come out, which I think is really important. And for these new bullet points, I think it's important that they all be parallel. So we start off with address property tax limits, protect shared revenues, and then in transportation, we say TIB grants. So we need to be clear about what we want to them to do that, you know, provide TIB funding or whatever. So let's add verbs at the front of every bullet point so that we're clear about what we want to happen with that item. And then at the last meeting, when you discussed this, you all had dots that you got to vote on legislative agenda items. And I came in and I used almost all of my dots on one of the transportation issues, which is address the 405-522 interchange structural deficiency. When I was looking at all of the verbiage for transportation, to me, the number one issue is dealing with that problem. I think that that is a huge problem that we're going to be spending years lobbying to get fixed. And then what I put in front of you was some additional language regarding just the transportation legislative agenda. I'm fine with everything else. And so I imagine that we're going to have additional clarification, like a third page that describes each of these bullet points like we've done in the past, or are we just going to give them these bullet points?
Excuse me. Actually, we were having some conversation. The mayor and I had talked about it. The thought would be maybe to actually invite the legislators once the elections are all over, actually to join you over dinner before a council meeting and actually go through them.
Okay.
And see if they stood alone and made sense.
Okay, well, that sounds great. One of the ones that I would like to propose to you is bullet number two in this little sheet that I put before you, which is oppose bonding against future toll revenue. What the legislature is considering is bonding against future toll revenue, which in essence locks the state into a permanent tolling system. Because if they're going to bond against it, then they're going to rely on those revenues. And I think a much better revenue source is our gas tax. And I put down below that tolling revenue. If you were donating to a charitable organization and you saw their overhead rate was 50%, you probably wouldn't donate to them because you want the majority of your money actually going to the service. Well, that's exactly what tolling revenue is. 50% is spent on overhead, whereas the gas tax is very efficient, 99.5% efficient. So I don't want, I would like us as a city to try to convince our legislators that bonding against future toll revenue is a poor idea. And then also, something that is under transportation, that's not really under transportation, which is this third bullet, which is fix the inherent social and financial inequities caused by tolling. I think we've heard a lot about the social inequity, you know, that tolling is available mostly to those who can afford it, and it doesn't reduce congestion. But I think another important thing that we tend to forget is the financial inequity of tolling. So it works great for people in Kirkland because they're paying 75 cents, but the minute you hit Bothell North, those drivers are paying $10. And so we're all paying into paying the bill, the $111 million bill of installing the tolling equipment, but Bothell and Northern residents pay far more towards that infrastructure cost than the Southern residents do, and yet we get the lowest service. And I think that that is really inequitable to our citizens. So if anything, I see that we don't want to make it too messy. We don't want to add too many goals, but I'm asking that at a minimum, we discuss tolling in our transportation section because it is so important, and we don't want to go to the legislators and give them the impression that tolling isn't an important issue for us still.
Okay, I'm going to ask for a motion from you here in just a second on the end of that, but I thought it was kind of important to know the dots since you brought up the dots. So I have the tally for the dots for each of these different items that are on the list if anybody is interested. So fiscal sustainability, address property tax cap limits. It's three people voted for that. Protect shared revenues, liquor, marijuana, and MRSC. There's five dots there. Transportation, TIB funding, and downtown Bothell TIB grant funds. There was seven, and I think that was the largest amount of dots. Address 405, 522 interchange structural deficiencies. There was four dots there. I suspect those were all... Those are yours. Economic development model, toxics control act funding, and DOE staffing. That's six. That's our second highest one. expand Lyft, adopt tax increment financing. Two people put dots on that. Education capital funding for UW-Bothell Cascadia. There's one dot. State schools funding without local revenue cuts and impacts. There was three dots. Community quality of life support association of Washington Cities, Sound Cities Association legislative proposals. And there's three dots. Municipal criminal prosecution and mental health funding. There was four dots. So do you have a motion that you would like to make to amend the... Oh, I'm sorry. Was there somebody else? I'm sorry. Councilmember...
Yeah.
We yield the floor for a second. Councilmember Sandberg?
Absolutely. I'd love to hear other people's responses to my suggestions.
Councilmember Fried.
Thank you for reading off the number of votes that were distributed or voted on with the sticky dots. Always a fun process. So if my understanding of what happened is underneath each one of those titles, we chose the majority of the dots under those titles. And it just so happened that we got two for each one. Is that?
I think we each had four. I can't remember how many dots we had.
We had six dots a piece, I think.
And I think these are the exact same line item things that we voted on. I think it's verbatim that the line item that we voted on.
Okay.
Oh, there it is. There's the.
No, it's good evidence.
Mr. Mayor, full disclosure, I did wait, and it might be unfair. So if people want to, comment on that, that issue was important to me that I used most of my dots. Because it wasn't on the list to start. And so if you want to, oppose it on that principle, then by all means.
Oh, so you did a write-in and put four votes. Okay.
Are you sure? I'm pretty sure I put a dot on that one.
It wasn't
really?
There.
Wow.
Okay. Cool. Yeah, that's great.
Oh, okay. So did you have any comments on Councilmember Sandberg's changes? Did anybody else want to look at the dots?
No, it's just helpful to be able to see. I just wanted to make sure, like, if there were, like in transportation, if we had seven dots, and there's only one down here for capital funding of UW-Cascadia, I think that's my one dot that I put there. But I just didn't. I appreciate the clarity on what that offered. Thank you.
Does anybody else have any comments on the proposed changes? Well, actually, you haven't made any motion, so is there any other discussion around the legislative priorities?
Mr. Mayor, if I could, I'll just hand this out while Councilmember Sandberg makes her motion, but you did by reference say we support the AWC priorities. We actually just got the most recent listing of how those summarized, and also a characterization on the back. I'll hand you guys a copy of that. Of some of the cuts that the state has made to city funds, where we in our comments said quit cutting the city's money, so that was attached. So I'll hand those out to you, so you have it. But that's by reference. You're referencing this.
I'm ready to make a motion.
Shoot.
I move that we add to the 2017 legislative agenda transportation subsection the third bullet before you, which is fix the inherent social and financial inequities caused by tolling. And we can either have the description of that after the fact. I think it as a like a separate white paper that we usually insert as explanatory information when we go to the legislators.
So we weren't planning on, I'm sorry, that's a motion, right?
If we put all that other verbiage in, those two bullets, it makes the rest of it unbalanced.
Right. So your motion is to just add, fix the inherent social and financial inequities caused by tolling and approve the rest of the legislative priorities as is?
Well, and then I have a second motion. But I'm going to go with one at a time.
Okay. Is there a second to the motion to add a bullet under the transportation to fix the inherent social and financial inequities caused by tolling?
Okay. Second motion is the second bullet. Oppose bonding against future toll revenues and utilize existing efficient revenue source, i.e. the gas tax.
Second.
So it's moved and seconded to add, and this is underneath the transportation bullet, an additional bullet that says oppose bonding against future toll revenues and utilize existing efficient revenue sources, get an example of gas tax.
Can I ask a clarifying question on this?
Sure.
Are you talking about oppose bonding for what? I would support bonding for against toll revenue for 405 projects, but if it's for anything other than 405, I would be opposed to that.
So thank you for the clarifying question. So there is this idea that we are going to be able to pay for the 405 improvements that we need, like at the 405, 522 interchange and beyond, that we're going to be able to pay for that with tolling revenue. And so this year, or the first year of revenue, the Department of Transportation reports that they've collected $20 million in toll revenue, which is great, until you realize that half of that, $10 million, goes to operating costs. So we're collecting $10 million of toll revenue. The cost to make the necessary improvements on 405 is estimated at $580 million. So at $10 million a year, we're looking at 58 years. At $20 million a year, you're looking at half of that. It's an incredibly inefficient way to collect revenue, and all of their goals of reducing congestion, those just aren't being met when you look at the data. And so I don't want the legislature to continue to commit to a revenue system that is incredibly inefficient, 50% efficient, and has these known elements of inequity to provide a payment system that just isn't realistic when the cost is so large. For example, just to let you know that the gas tax, when we talk about how inefficient the revenue collection is, for the tolls, there are 12 million unique drivers. So they're collecting money from 12 million unique drivers, which is why they have so many problems in overcharging and bill payment. I mean, they're rife with problems. Whereas the gas tax revenue is collected directly from 200 refineries. It's a system that's in place. It's a system that works. And that is a system that we should be using and modifying to increase revenue to deal with these projects, a 99.5% efficient system versus a 50% efficient system.
Okay, thank you.
Deputy Mayor.
So I had a clarifying question. The $580 million for 405, is that the entire 405 system that you're talking about? Because
it's my understanding that it's the interchange, it's the fixing of the 522-405 interchange and the addition of lanes from that point up to I-5.
Because okay, that's not the number that I understand it.
What number do you understand it to be?
Well, from WashDOT, we've been told that the interchange, and maybe this is the difference, the interchange itself is $300 million. So I'm not sure. But anyway, can I make other comments, or are we?
Go ahead and make your comments, because okay, we have other council members that want to speak to okay, the motion.
The other thing that I wanted to point out is that, and I'm torn on this issue, of that $20 million, $11 million is going toward the hard shoulder fix between 527 and I-5. And so that money is going to help Bothell traffic, which is a little difficult to take the money and then argue against the tolls.
Councilmember Freed.
Great, thanks. Councilmember Sandberg, I hope that you can take some of my time and answer back, because you and your family, I know, have invested a lot of time in this discussion, your brother-in-law. And when you guys get together for dinner, I imagine there's some discussion on tolling. So thank you for the work that your family's doing there. My question is, when I look at the bullet that you're suggesting, oppose bonding against future tolls, bonding can be a useful mechanism. So while we're all here today paying that toll, if we decide to pay that toll, we get to benefit from part of what we're paying for, $20 million that you said this year, where if we wait until all that cash comes, we will never be a benefit. beneficiary of that. So that's one question I'd love for you to get to. The gas tax I see as oppressive on more lower-income people that most likely are moving, or, for example, living in Marysville because they can't afford to buy a house in Bothell and they work in Bellevue. So they're paying far more tax than a more affluent person who's able to live closer to work. So that's why I lean more toward if people are willing to pay a toll and we can bond off that toll in the form of like a debt to pay for improvements today, that's why I like that system. I don't know if you're willing to shoot that down or answer or whatever your thoughts would be.
I wouldn't want to shoot it down. It's a valid point. I think it is important to, if you have a revenue stream and you have the ability to bond against it so that you can get improvements sooner rather than later. And I think that that is reasonable. I just oppose bonding against toll revenue because that locks us in to a system that is inefficient. So I'm not opposed to the concept of bonding. I'm opposed to bonding against the toll revenue because they're looking at duplicating, putting in, you know, I don't know how much, what the cost of the tolling equipment is south 405. The cost for 405, our portion, our, you know, the stuff that we see now was $111 million. So I just feel like if we bond against that toll revenue, we're committing ourselves to digging deeper into a hole. And to address your second point about impacting lower income families more, I agree that is an important point. Gas tax revenue doesn't have to be the only means to generate revenue in a more efficient manner. I mean, there's things like a motor vehicle excise tax. I don't want to give the impression that we don't want to pay for the improvements. We should pay for the improvements, but we should pay for the improvements in an efficient manner, not an inefficient one.
Great. Thank you so much for your thoughts on it. I appreciate it. I won't be supporting, but I think you make a good argument.
Councilmember McNeil.
Thank you. So I had a question going to the gas tax. As we become more energy efficient, do you have a model that shows how much the gas tax revenue will raise for us?
Well, I don't, but the gas tax is based on a percentage cost per barrel, I believe. Is that right?
Per gallon.
Or per gallon, but it's a percentage on a per gallon versus the MOCTA funds is a set amount per barrel. And you can simply increase the percentage.
So we would increase the percentage of tax on a gallon or a barrel. Mm-hmm. But as we go and try to go more energy efficient, would that affect the income we're able to raise off of that funding source?
Well, potentially, but there are other mechanisms to collect revenue that are more efficient if you're even in a moving towards a more fuel efficient economy. So there are other means. The gas tax is just one example.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so I think everybody's had a chance to speak that has wanted to. I just a couple of quick things, at least from looking at these. I despise the tolls. I think it's a horrible system and it is inefficient. However, it's not our deal. And I think if there's changes politically, if the tolls went away, that would be great. But I think what we have in front of us is assuming that the tolls aren't going away. And we don't control the tolls. The city does not have any purview over the state and whether or not we are going to have tolls or not. So I kind of like what we have in here because we're saying address the problems that you have caused with tolling, because from what I understand, and I would be surprised, I mean, I'd be happy, but I'd be surprised if the tolling ceased. So that's my comment. Okay, so we have a motion on the floor that's been seconded. It was seconded, right? Yeah, okay. To add the bullet under transportation to oppose bonding against future toll revenue and utilize existing efficient revenue sources such as gas tax. Any further discussion on the motion? Councilmember Spivey.
As much as I don't support tolling, I can't support an additional increases in gas tax. So I'll be voting against it. We've got one of the highest gas taxes in the country, as it is. And we're with the increase in alternative fuels being out there, there's got to be another means of having equity across the board, because it's the more affluent are the ones that are using the alternative fuels, and the more the blue collar folks are still driving gas. So I think that becomes an inequitable tax as well. So as much as I don't like the tolling, I also don't like an increase in a gas tax. So I'll be voting no.
Councilmember Agnew.
I will not be supporting this. I know that I seconded it, and I wanted to second it for discussion and discussion only. I too don't think tolling is the answer, but I also don't think raising the gas taxes are the answer either. With more and more fuel efficient cars and Tesla coming out with a car that's electric that the John Doe citizen can buy, I think that's going to have a huge impact on transportation. I agree with the mayor that we are not going to solve the transportation issues on this dais. They are long and arduous, and I think we're going to put up with it the rest of our lifetimes anyway. So I will not be supporting the motion.
All right, any further discussion? Are we ready for a vote? Looks like we're ready, so go ahead and place your vote. Can you clear the vote, clerk? Please revote. Ouch. Fails 6 in the negative, Councilmember Sandberg in the positive. So we still have legislative priorities that need to be approved. Do we have a motion to approve the legislative priorities?
Second.
It's moved by Councilmember McNeil, and then seconded by Deputy Mayor Dewar to approve the legislative priorities. Please place your vote unless there's discussion on the motion. Councilmember Sandberg?
I ask that we make the bullet points parallel by adding verbs to the beginning of each bullet point so that we clarify what exactly we want to happen.
I'll second that. Does that make sense? I'm seeing nods. Okay. So that is an amending motion, right?
I would like that to be amending motion.
Okay, good. It's been seconded. Is there any discussion on the motion to add actionable verbs to the beginning of the bullets that do not have them? Councilmember Fried?
Can we take 60 seconds to actually say what those verbs are? Because TMB funding, are we increasing TMB funding, offering more opportunities for TMB funding? I don't want to take more time because we're over almost by an hour anyway, but
right.
If I were the author verbs. Who drafted it, as I am, and I were looking for a verb, I would say support.
Can you go down the line here, the interim city manager, and just give us
well,
a verb?
Well, again, I would support the model toxic wakes because that's the one missing a verb, and support capital funding.
Good.
And support state schools funding. And I guess
support municipal criminal prosecution and mental health funding.
Yeah, I guess the key verb in case would be support, I think.
The verb is support.
That's excellent.
That's good. Are you okay with that, with your amending motion over there, Councilmember Sandberg, that the verb will be support where there's no verb currently?
I have a problem with support from a pharmaceutical perspective because that's what supplements say, and that's the only thing they can say, and it really means nothing, but I'm going to go with support in the interest of time.
Great. Thank you. All right. If there's no further discussion, please place your vote to add support to any line that does not have support or a verb to begin the bullet. Go ahead, place your vote. Adding verbs. That's good. This is painful. All right. Passes unanimously. So we have the underlying motion to approve the legislative agenda. Any further discussion on the motion? Good. Place your vote. Are we ready to vote, City Clerk? No, not ready. There it is. Place your vote. Passes unanimously. So moving on, my computer's asleep because we've been talking about this for so long. I think we are on to the visitor section, aren't we? Okay, good. So I have one sign-up sheet. Just real quick for the visitor section, we have this little excerpt I need to read real quick. Addressing the council, each person addressing the council will give his or her name in an audible tone, a voice for the record, and unless council grants further time, shall limit the address to 3 minutes. All remarks will be addressed to the council as a body and not to any member thereof. No person other than the council and the person having the floor will be permitted to enter into any discussion, either directly or through a member of the council without the permission of the mayor. And we have one sign-up sheet, which is Al Fangenbaum.
I want to ask everybody in this room a question. Everybody. Everybody here. I have a simple question. How many of you are willing to underwrite my cost of housing? Nobody want to pay my rent? None of you want to pay my rent? But yet you're willing to put money into what you call affordable housing, paying other people's rent? Why not mine? Why not his? Why not hers? I don't think you people understand your municipal protocol, of which I have a copy of the pertinent section on page 34, on subsection F of whatever came before. It says prohibited acts. I'll read it to you. No municipal officer may use his or her position to secure special privileges or exemptions for himself, herself, or others. In other words, you cannot spend city money on special interest groups and people who you consider to be requiring housing support have to qualify by certain financial measures or whatever. They are a special interest group. And you're supposed to use tax dollars for the public. The public is not a special interest group. We're all part of the public. But you're willing to make money available to a special interest group. That is people who are indigent, low income, and you call it affordable housing. All housing is affordable. If you live in it, it's affordable. Bill Gates' house is affordable to Bill Gates. My house is affordable to me. All of you, your houses are affordable to you. There's no such thing as affordable housing. That's a euphemism for indigent housing and cheap housing. And I am not in favor of my tax dollars being spent this way. Now, we are all responsible for our own lives. What I'm getting at here is if you're indigent, you have a low-income job, is that my fault? Is that your fault? Your fault? No. It's the fault of the person who has the low-income job, who didn't pursue an education, didn't have whatever it takes to do better than what they've done with their lives. I am where I am because of decisions I made early on. The same can be said of every one of you and every one of the people sitting here. Now, I have nothing against indigent housing, but the people who should be providing it are NGOs, not the City Council of Bothell or the City Council of any other city. That's my opinion. And I interpret this to say, or others, means that you cannot provide money or special favors to any special interest group. That's what it says here. That's what it means to me. I'm not a lawyer. Maybe the city attorney has a different opinion. You all may have a different opinion. Maybe it makes you feel good. Oh, I'm going to contribute to subsidized housing for the poor. I'm not responsible for people being poor. There are people wealthier than me. I'm living in, I would call, cheap housing, because I moved out of my apartment when I kept raising my rent, and I bought something I could afford, which cost me about $40,000. But that's on me. That's not on you. I'm not asking anybody for any favors. But at the same time, you are asking me to vote for Proposition 1, which gives you money for city streets, but you want to take money that you don't have and provide it for indigent housing in the city of Bothell. I think that's a dumb idea.
Okay, could you wrap up your comments, please? Your time ends up.
Well, I want you people to think about your commitment to what you call affordable housing. It's not a good idea. You're not responsible for anybody else's economic situation. Neither am I. And if people are unable to afford what they would like to have, well, that's on them. Same as on me, on all of you, on all of us.
Thank you, sir. Is there anybody else in the public that would like to speak to the council tonight?
Mr. Mayor, can I?
Councilmember Sandberg, we are way over time. I'm sorry, I'm trying to just keep this going. We're at least an hour past our scheduled time. We're going to be here till 11:30 if we don't start reining this in.
Well, then maybe at some point our city attorney can address that code citation.
City attorney, could you work with him in the hallway? That'd be great.
And I do have opinion about that. And let me just say briefly in 15 seconds.
No. We are going to move on in the agenda.
It'll take you 15 seconds to say no.
So is there anybody else in the public that would like to speak to the council?
I would.
You only have one turn at a meeting. Sir, please, we really do need to move on our agenda. So seeing none, we have two other additional items added to the agenda, one of them being the pedestrian accident of a 7-year-old child at Woodmore Elementary. And Councilmember Sandberg, you added this to the agenda.
Thank you. On Friday afternoon, a second grader from Woodmore Elementary was hit as he was crossing the street. And I unfortunately don't know many of the details. I don't know if police is available to give us some details, but in circumstances like this, I don't know if other of you on council have received blowback from the community, have heard it on social media, but there's always the expression of, we've been telling you this is a problem, why didn't you do anything about it? And now, you know, my predictions have come true. And I the reason why I brought it up, because I think that we need to have some information and clarity on this incident, because it crosses jurisdictions. On the it happened near the 124th 160th Street intersection. Half of that street is in Woodinville, half is in Bothell. There's a lot of anger that's focused in at Bothell. I know that there are crossing guards and parents going to Woodinville City Council tonight to talk about this very issue. And I know that based on public comment, that the police have had a significant presence, increase in their presence around the school zones this year. And for that, I thank them for that. And people on social media have also commented on that. So I don't know if staff has any additional information for us, but the one thing I did want to say, and this is based on my experience of walking my child to the elementary school for 7 years, talking with other parents, talking with school crossing guards, is that a significant portion of the offenders in these school zones, speeding, going through the intersection while there are people in it, harassing crossing guards, any number of bad behaviors. A significant portion of the people who commit those are the parents that are driving their kids to school. And I think that this is a community effort. It's not just a policing effort. And I would respectfully ask that as parents, and I'm sure I have been guilty of this myself, that we exercise extra special caution in school zones 100% of the time. Because if we can't do that, then what I'm going to start advocating for, and I don't know if the Spokane Review or Spokesman Review article was sent to you, I'm going to start advocating for cameras in school zones, not as a means to generate revenue, but as a means to modify behavior. And I'm also gonna ask for increased enforcement and ticketing. And I don't know how much ticketing is going on. We've tried this approach of education and encouragement. And I think at some point we have to decide whether the only way we're going to modify behavior is to make people pay for it.
So, Councilmember Sandberg, before we go to the police chief, the deputy mayor and I have been working this issue since it occurred on Friday. So I'm going to give the floor to her, and then I'll add if she misses anything that we've already worked on this.
Okay. So I, that is my school. My daughter goes to Woodmore. So I met with the principal yesterday, Angela Kerr, and a couple of her staff, and this is what I learned. The child was running across the street rather than in a crosswalk and without adult supervision that usually accompanies him. His older brother apparently tried to call him back to no avail. The driver was 62. It's an ongoing investigation. They don't know if the driver was speeding. However, I wanted to note that the principal had enormous praise for the very noticeable increase in police presence on the Bothell side of her campus. They did have some requests. I'll read them off real quickly. Similar to you, they said, just we need tickets to be written. Parents are pulling off of 160th on the road and letting their kids out. Parents are using the, parents and other drivers are using the turn lane as an actual lane. There's speeding, there's driving through red lights. They asked if we could have a flashing sign between the junior high and elementary schools to remind drivers they're in a school zone. They would love to have an officer just once in a while drive through the parking lot, not to enforce anything, but just to remind parents, because even in the parking lot, they don't obey the speed limit. And they're wondering if the 5 mile per hour speed limit is unrealistic and easier to ignore because of that. And then they would be interested at some time, maybe in the spring, to have the police come and talk to kids about safety. The other concerns they have are really concerns that they need to share with Woodinville, because there are a lot of issues on 124th, and that's not our area. So that's what I learned, and I know we're trying to set up a meeting between Woodinville and Bothell around this issue.
And I emailed all the mayors involved. Kirkland's close, but not exactly in the exact location, but did talk to Woodinville as well. We sent that email to Woodinville City Council, or the mayor of Woodinville, and they're going to bring it up tonight at their council meeting. But I did want to emphasize that the presence of our police with the existing staff has been very notable, not only at this school, but throughout all the school zones during kids coming and going from school. So we have done something in the last 6 months that I really do appreciate the chief and all the hard work of the Bothell Police Department and what they've done. Chief, did you have anything you wanted to add?
I believe that was a very good assessment of the situation. The child ran out into the street, striking the right or the left front of the van. And at the scene, I was told that there was no indication of impairment. Of course, since this is a child that's been injured, the sheriff's office brought out their major accident reconstruction unit to do the assessment. But at the time that I talked to the chief yesterday, there was no enforcement taken on the driver. That being said, I can completely concur with the comments that our children, they're children. And so we need to do the best we can to ensure their safety and recognize that children sometimes will do things like run out into the street. And so we need to ensure that speeds are enforced and that they're low in the area of schools for that very reason.
Thank you, Chief. Councilmember Sandberg.
Are we going to be having a joint meeting with Woodinville and Kirkland about this, or are you just communicating with the mayors yourself? Because if that's the case, there is another issue I would like you to communicate with.
The city manager of Woodinville reached out to us. They'd like to have a meeting.
Okay.
I just don't think we've had a chance to respond yet.
Who's we?
Bothell and Woodinville. I don't know about
the
Kirkland.
Full councils. You know.
They didn't indicate, okay. So we need to decide what we're going to do.
So we're working on it, definitely. That's a very tragic event. So anybody else would like to speak to this? Nope. Okay, moving on to the additional. Councilmember Freed, you want to talk about the video pro-con statements?
That's right. Okay. So as a city, as a council, majority passed to obviously we put on the ballot the safe streets and sidewalks measure to go up for vote. The city's taken some action since then, affirmative actions, right, offering informative, so like up on the website, just what it is all about. We've also done a video. Then as a city, we offered the opportunity to the yes and to the no side. The yes side answered and said to put a video up, and our PIO, Barbara, can certainly speak to this as well. There were three emails, from my understanding, that were sent to the no chairman, not the other two committee members, and from what I can understand, that went into the junk mail, and they didn't see it. There were no follow-up phone calls or texts that were sent or any forms of communication, so basically, the no campaign was left without the opportunity to have a voice, which I think is problematic because it makes it so the message is only one-sided. Whether you agree with the issue or not, I think this council wants to make sure that we are fair and balanced on making sure both perspectives are getting out to our citizens. Now, it gets to be an awkward position at this time, and Paul can speak to it, but I think it's right for the council as a whole to be able to have the full knowledge of where we are today. The conversation is difficult at this time now that the yes video has been up for 2 weeks or 3 weeks, whatever the period of time is. Now for the no campaign to come in, it would be as if they had the ability to counter the comments or statements of the yes campaign. But I think the no campaign was put in a spot that they never really were given the opportunity to put the video up. So it's an awkward situation, but I'm wondering if, as a council, there would be support to allow them to put a video up, even though at this point they'd probably only be up for 5 days.
Does anybody want to speak to this discussion item? Oh, Interim City Manager.
A couple of concerns. And I don't want to get, and Paul can help if I misstate this. There's a distinction drawn between the city's role in providing actual information, what we do in our flyers, the newsletter, the Bothell Bridge, that kind of official information. And that's the stuff we vet pretty closely to make sure it's the factual information. Then there's the vehicle, like the Video Voters Guide, where we provide the platform, but we do not deal with the content. It's called a limited public forum, but we're not dealing with the content that the council approved, two committees, a pro committee and a con committee. The council said those are the people who will be allowed access to our limited public forum. The limited public forum was the official voter's guide that went to the county or the counties, and in this case, the video voter's guide. I guess I would agree. I mean, we treated both committees the same, and we communicated with the chair of those committees. Apparently, in hindsight, I don't know what happened. The chair didn't notice, of the con committee didn't notice it or something. And so, no, we didn't send copies to every member of that committee. In hindsight, that probably would have been better. Having said that, this matter was brought to my attention by both our communications officer and the city attorney, saying, what do we do? So we had a conversation about it. The pro committee actually responded and put out their message. The con committee did not respond for maybe a variety of reasons, but nonetheless, from a public forum standpoint, I had nothing to put out there. The concern I then had was these were to be two independently offered points of view, pro and con, by the council appointed committees. We would not reach out to anyone else other than the council appointed committees to ask them, well, do you want a view? Do you want to put something up? That's not our role as a city. Our role is to provide this platform for these two groups, the council appointed pro and con committee. The concern I next had, I mean, we could take everything down, but the one group complied, the other group, for a variety of reasons, didn't. But we could take down the statements by the group that complied. The concern I would have, though, about allowing the other point of view, these are not intended to be point, counterpoint, or rebuttal. They were to be two independently produced statements. I think this is a good idea. I think this is a bad idea. Not, I disagree with why they said it was a good idea, and here's why. that's a pro-con rebuttal kind of thing. And I don't think that's consistent with the limited public forum. And that's why I said no. So I suppose if council is uneasy with the video voter's guide, the only thing that I could support, and I'll let Paul weigh in, would be if you said take it down. And we certainly could do that because it's a platform and we've offered both sides an opportunity on the platform. We can take that platform down. But at this juncture, to add additional content by anyone who had the opportunity to vote, to view the opposing point of view, I think that would be inherently unfair. So that was how I came to the conclusion I did, perfectly willing to either let it run as it is running or take it down. But I can't support adding in another program at this point when that would have, I guess, unless you gave both sides the opportunity to do a rebuttal, but then you, when does it stop? So anyway, that was the distinction we were making. I didn't want it to be confused between things like the Bothell Buzz, things like the Bothell Bridge, the flyers, some of the official information programs. Those are different from the video voter guide and the limited public forum. So those are my comments.
Yeah, and in response to what Interim City Manager said in terms of taking everything down, I have some concerns about that as well. We do have an executive session already scheduled for potential litigation. I do think that this discussion would fall within that potential litigation format. My suggestion would be that we address this issue in executive session, and then we can address this at the end of the meeting to discuss what role or what option we want to take, whether to take it down, to allow the con side to put one up, or to do nothing. But I have serious concerns about removing what has already been placed there.
So you would recommend us to just table this for now, or do you, unless you, there's a majority of council that says just do nothing?
Correct.
Now?
Correct. If a majority of council says do nothing, then I think we can go forward with that. If you'd like there to be discussion on why, I think there'd be legal concerns with removing the content that's already there. I think we should do that in executive session towards the end of the meeting that's already scheduled.
Okay. So I'll chime in first, just real quick for time's sake. I think that an important lesson, well, there's two important lessons. I think a video voter's guide, I think, is a great idea. I'm glad that you added that to our potential ways to communicate with voters, or to allow, I'm sorry, the different groups to communicate to the voters, and providing that forum. I think that's a really good thing. The other lesson learned, I think, is that definitely contact all committee members that have been appointed by the city council instead of just the chair in going forward. The last thing is that I don't think it's a good idea to take it down or to allow a new video to be taken because of the reasons that were given by the interim city manager, in that it's not fair to one side or the other to allow for a rebuttal video compared to just a independent video being done earlier on during the whatever October I believe it was. So I'm gonna do nothing. Councilmember Sandberg.
In a paper voter guide, there are deadlines for when the original statements have to go in and the rebuttal statements have to go in, so that there isn't an undue advantage, an unfair advantage. Are we held to those same standards for this video voter's guide? Or can we just, is it within our legislative purview to make a decision one way or another without fear of legal backlash?
Yeah, Paul can correct me. I think these are rules that we made for ourselves, but once we set what those dates were, then we had to comply, you know, by our own self-imposed rule. But no, the state law doesn't tell us how to do a video voter's guide. But what we said was we need a response by X, and we gave each side the similar notice, and we gave each side opportunity to have access to the videographer to produce their program.
So do you weigh in on what do you want to do?
I agree with Councilmember Freed that whether you're pro or con on this issue, there is an appearance of bias. And I've always been one for bring on the arguments and let's hear them. And it seems as though we made mistakes in notifying the the CON committee. And so I feel in the interest of having all the discussion out there, allowing them to submit a CON video, as long as that's not going to set us up for some kind of legal challenge where then we're, you know, expending a lot of effort more than tonight in fighting that decision.
So you had to add a video. Okay, Deputy Mayor.
I guess my issue is that we already extended the deadline to even get a committee. And if positions were reversed, I can't imagine we wouldn't have an issue. If it were the pro side that this happened to, where would we be? Because then it would be, oh, the city's biased because they're the ones who are putting it out. So I just think I'm a rule follower. The rules are the rules, and we already extended the deadline to even get a CON committee. I'm concerned we can just throw all the rules out at that point, you know, if we're going to. We have to, at some point, draw the line on what the rules are.
So do nothing, take it down, or add the CON committee video?
Do nothing.
Councilmember Agnew.
I agree with Deputy Mayor. I think there were rules made. There was opportunities by both committees to get their information to people. I think at this point in time, it would be an unfair advantage to have somebody already look at what people are saying and then rebuttal it. I would vote do nothing.
Councilmember McNeil.
I agree with the Deputy Mayor and Councilmember Agnew. However, it's a hard one because it's important that we make sure that we have open and transparent government. And in this particular case, I know we're supposed to stay out of it. So in listening to the interim city manager and our attorney speak about the possible litigation issues that we could be facing when we're supposed to be staying out of something to begin with, I'm for doing nothing or, if need be, discussing an exec about what those problems could be. But at this point, I haven't heard anything to say we should move forward, in my opinion.
Councilmember Spivey.
excuse me. I think we need to have a discussion in executive session, but I also feel that if we were to allow the CON committee that it, just make sure that it's their basically their CON statement in the county voter's guide, not allow a rebuttal statement. But my vote right now is to have a discussion in exec.
So I don't have a majority on any of them. So we'll just do an exec. Well, no, because Councilmember McNeil wants to have a discussion in exec, I believe. Or are you a solid do nothing?
I'm a solid do nothing.
Okay, so there's a majority. Okay, Councilmember Fried, do you have any?
Oh, to answer
final words.
Which one to do? I brought up the issue, but I didn't speak to which one of these, right?
Oh, okay. I thought you did. Sorry.
Well, maybe I don't think I did. Maybe I did. One of the board members is Jean Zorns. We don't often see eye to eye, as people know, but I highly respect her. She thinks through a lot of different issues. She's on the CON committee. I know members on the pro committee, I don't often agree with them, but I think there's respect on both sides, respect enough that they could sit down at a table and say, hey, we want to do a video. Is that all right with you? I imagine they would say absolutely, because we know that you are passionate about your issues and we are as ours. I think there could be some coming together. But as far as the city saying out of this, I think the city's actually gone and potentially advocated with Facebook ads and others. It sounds like information, but there's been a lot coming, it seems, from one side, and that's my concern, the perception of more advocacy for yes than giving another side of the story. So I would be for allowing a conversation for the video between the sides.
Just briefly, speaking to Councilmember Spivey, the concern that I would have about the suggestion you made about limiting what they say to the voter's guide, I think that would be impermissible in terms of limiting the free speech that they would be able to exercise. in advocating for their point. So I think if we were to limit what they could say, that would also be a concern for the city.
Fair enough. Thank you.
Okay. So it looks like we are doing, there's a majority of council or four council members that would prefer not to get involved with this. This has not been the purview of the city council whatsoever. And sounds like we're going to keep it that way. So our next agenda item will push us past the 9 p.m. Is everybody okay not taking a break, or do we need a break? Okay, so can we have a motion to extend the meeting first, and then we'll go for a break?
Move to extend to 10 o'clock.
Okay. It's moved and it's seconded that we will leave by 10 o'clock, which is very wishful, but is there any discussion on the motion? None, place your vote. Place your vote. Place your vote. Passes with Councilmember Freed in the negative, passes 6-1. So we're going to go to a break for 10 minutes, and we'll be back at 10 to 9 o'clock. Bothell City Council is back in session. We're going to start with AB 16-180, which is the Wayne Golf Course acquisition process. And we have the Parks and Recreation Director, John Keats, to kick us off with the presentation. There he is. Good. Welcome.
Good evening, Mayor, members of council. Yeah, it's my pleasure. We're going to just give you a brief update on the Wayne Golf Course process, acquisition process. And also with us tonight are from Forterra is Michelle Connor and Liz Johnston. So part of the presentation. So there we go. So just real briefly, quick PowerPoint, about 10 slides. I'm going to go over University of Washington landscape architecture class, update on our RCO grants, appraisal and memorandum of understanding. Michelle's going to talk about purchase expectations, and then we'll open up for questions, comments, and council direction. As we speak, we have a class from the University of Washington landscape architecture program that has taken on the Wayne course as a project. So they're going to look at the visioning work they've done that's been done so far and just kind of see what they can add to that. So we'll be meeting them again in May, and then by December they should have some final recommendations for the golf course. And again, this is the work that we got earlier in the year when we did the visioning portion. So they're very excited, and so far have expressed a lot of good information and a lot of enthusiasm. Also, with the grant situation, the city and county submitted a number of grant applications in the past RCO grant round. Real briefly, the water access grant for $1 million that ranked 11 out of 15 applications. It could possibly receive funding because there's a statutory requirement for a number of acquisitions to be funded along with development projects. So we really won't know that until the legislature meets and funds the WWRP program. King County Riparian Protection Grant, $1 million also, ranked 8 out of 11. Very unlikely that would get funded. And then King County put in the Aquatic Lands Enhancement Account, ILEA grant for $1 million. That ranks 7th out of 23 applications. It could potentially receive funding. I think in talking to Liz, it would need, the legislature would need to up the funding about $250,000 more than what they have traditionally done for the Wayne project to be funded. And then we're waiting to hear from the Floodplains by Design, $500,000. I think we should hear on that this week. And then RCO, we have a surfboard grant, and we've actually made it a request. They've actually made us put in a request to actually up that that grant for $75,000. And this just gives you a bigger view of what we've got potentially secured and in for the back nine and the front nine. I know for a fact we have about $3.1 million secured. The surfboard PSAR grant there, still waiting to hear on that. Good chance we'll get that, so could be upwards of $4 million secured. And then the ones in red are the grants I just went over that are still pending or waiting to hear what the results will be. I was hoping to be able to go into an appraisal tonight, but unfortunately the appraiser didn't get us the appraisal, so I'll have to defer that to another council meeting. As you know, the Forterra did purchase the property in two separate transactions for $10,125,000, and what we're waiting for from the appraiser is the value, the updated value on the front nine, back nine, and the potential value for conservation easement on the back nine. And we're also working with Forterra and King County on a memorandum of understanding, basically regarding some funding that we, holding costs they have for 2015 in the amount of about $99,000, would split that 50-50 with King County. The memo of understanding more or less though would guide the working relationship for the repayment and acquisition of the golf course. And then purchase expectations, Forterra sent us a letter August 15th of this year. At this point, I'll turn it over to Michelle just to go over some of the highlights of the letter. And then after that, that'll more or less be the conclusion of the presentation.
Good evening, Mayor, members of the council. I totally honor your endurance. You guys are amazing. So I'm just here tonight to acknowledge the letter that I provided to the city with our requested terms for a transaction. And just to highlight those, we financed the purchase of this property with 20 civically minded guarantees and Forterra's balance sheet. Those guarantees were supported by our major donors, which means we're not receiving donations from them for our operating costs right now because of their investment in this. And so that leads to our financial request for support from you so we can keep doing what we do. Thank you for your consideration on that front. The specific requests in the letter, and I'm happy to address these in further detail, but you do have the letter provided, and I understand you'll be discussing it, is coverage of the unreimbursed staff costs, which John mentioned, a transaction fee, which is how we do the kind of advance work that we did in emergent situations like the Wayne property, and reimbursement of our uncovered ownership costs, should there be any, purchase costs, closing and financing costs. So pretty straightforward. We're proposing to sell it to you for the price that we paid in exchange for the certainty around those sort of exposures that we had for stepping in. With that, I'd just say you guys have an amazing opportunity with this property, and we're so proud to be working with you on it for all the benefits it can provide from habitat to active rec. I'm available to answer any questions you might have.
First off, sorry I didn't call you back. You called me.
Oh, no.
I didn't call you back. I apologize. I did have a chance to talk to your colleague, though. So
yeah, and I'd love to acknowledge Liz because she's been the project manager. So
yeah, is there any questions for Forterra or staff? Councilmember McNeil.
I too wanted to acknowledge and thank you for everything that you at Forterra are doing, not only for us here in Bothell but across the region. To preserve our way of life here in Washington. So I did want to give a shout out to you guys for that. King County, for your tireless work and effort. And Liz, thank you for being present at all those meetings. It's been very important. It's been an enlightening process to go through those meetings on the Wayne acquisition. And I look forward to seeing what we can do to get this thing completed. So thank you very much for all your work.
Thank you to the council for its leadership.
Councilmember Spivey.
Great, thank you. I do have a question of staff. Or staff, there we go. Do we run any problems using any of the monies that we've secured to help cover these costs with Forterra that they're requesting?
I don't believe so. For example, the payment to that their request for the project management and such for 2015, we can pay with Conservation Futures. So I don't think right now any of this would be, any of the activities would be ineligible if it's related to the purchase of the property. But it can change from grant to grant. But I'm just the ones that we have so far. I don't know that there'd be any problems. And I don't know. Maybe defer to Liz and that. Yeah, I don't think so. Yeah, okay. I think we're okay.
Great, thank you.
Councilmember Sandberg.
Director Keats, just so I'm clear, the $50,000 that we're being asked to contribute towards the carrying costs, you're saying that $50,000 isn't something that's coming out of our general fund, it's coming out of grant monies that we have already secured or received for the project?
Correct. Checked with King County, and we can fund that with the Conservation Futures dollars we've already been allocated.
Okay. And then should we expect to see carrying costs like this every year until we are able to purchase the property?
Yes. Yeah. There'll be project management costs, interest, property taxes, a whole host of things that could enter into the equation. So.
And is is it expected that it'll be roughly $99,000 a year, or is it something will increase in over time, decrease over time?
It's less the sooner the city would purchase, but each of them are a little different. So it's like there's financing fees and those sorts of things. So and they would be probably more than $50,000 or the $49,000 we're paying right now. So it could. So yes, they'll be more than what we're looking at presently tonight.
Okay, thank you.
Deputy Mayor.
Hi, John. Thanks. Hi. I was thinking perhaps it would be helpful to explain why we're waiting for the, what's it called, assessment or the appraisal, because that might explain how we intend to try to draw down what those carrying costs are.
Well, I'm not sure I exactly understand your question.
Well, today in the meeting we discussed being able to put some, well, getting the appraisal and breaking the Wayne Golf Course into smaller pieces, right? See, and paying off what we can with the grants we have.
Right. Yeah, the back nine has five parcels and, you know, potential there with the grant money we had, you could start buying individual parcels. Now, the front nine, you could not do that because it's one contiguous parcel. The other thing the appraisal will do is also give us a potential value for a conservation easement for the back nine under two different scenarios.
Councilmember Agnew.
I too would like to thank all of you for all the effort that you've been doing in this endeavor. I think it's going to be great to save this for the future residents of Bothell for my grandkids. But to be nitpicky, I think on your second page you had a single family residence on the front nine. I think that's on the back nine.
Yes, that would be on the back.
Great. Councilmember Freed, did you have anything you want to add?
Oh, I was just pointing out to our city manager was.
Okay. Interim city manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Two things. We've got a memorandum of understanding that we'll talk to you about in executive session this evening that would basically set the foundation for this formal relationship between Forterra. Whenever council's ready, then I can sign it and you can say, okay, that looks good. And John's just talked to you about the key element of that, which is it's 49,000 some, but almost 50,000 is our share. So that would be the first issue. The second issue, and I really can't discuss a lot of the particulars about it yet, but I expect that by the time we get to the budget discussion on November 15, that I may have an ability to make a very positive recommendation to you on purchasing this property earlier rather than later. There's some things that are in play that will develop between now and that meeting that may be of some real advantage to us. So. I just wanted to put it out there for council that my thinking at this point, given the carrying costs, and I don't have any objections to the carrying costs that Forterra has identified, but they're big. And the sooner we can buy this property and get it under public city ownership, the better. And we did have a conversation today with the Councilmember Dombrowski's office staffer as well, and I think the county shares our view in that. So. With that as just a teaser for don't miss the November 15 budget meeting. We may have some positive recommendations for you by that meeting. So those were the two thoughts I wanted to put out there.
Councilmember Freed.
Wow, you put great little trailers out there, little blurbs, grand excitement. Come to our budget meeting. You make a statement, interim city manager, regarding the fees that are coming. I think Council Member Sandberg did as well. Do we have a schedule of what we could be expecting? We do. Okay.
Great. I had a quick question. So in the letter, it said that they Forterra would like to have signage on the property after it's owned by the city. And I was just curious to kind of what does the typical signage look like? Is it like a big bright billboard with lit up letters, or what are we talking about?
We'd be delighted to work with the city on something that would be acceptable.
Okay, I'm just curious. Yeah. Just thought I'd ask, because you never know.
Extremely tasteful.
Okay, no billboards. All right, neon billboards. The deputy mayor wanted to thank you guys. Go ahead, deputy mayor.
I always forget myself when I'm asking questions. I really appreciate the process and all the hard work that you've put into this. I'm sure the other council members share my thoughts in terms of just how much support we've received from Forterra and the county and One Bothell. And this has been a really great experience, and I'm sure it will be going forward.
And I just want to echo that as well. I work on a lot of committees, and that's one of my most memorable and enjoyable committee that I've been part of in the last 5 years of doing this work as a council member and as the mayor. So thank you guys. I really appreciate it. I think I've said this a few times now, but it also is just huge to see a nonprofit, King County, and a city all work towards something together of this magnitude. None of us could have done it by ourselves, but together we're definitely going to get it done. So I appreciate what everybody has done. One last thing, I saw in there that the floodplain by design money for $500,000. I personally signed a letter to support the funding of floodplain by design. And then I also, as YR8, we signed a letter to support it. So you might want to remind them of that when it comes time to decide whether we get funding. That's okay. Anything else? No more, not another round. We're good. Okay. Thank you. Appreciate it. Next on our agenda is a public hearing, AB 16-181, public hearing ordinance establishing new user rates for utility services, water, sanitary sewer, and stormwater. I'm officially opening the public hearing, and we have Don Fien to provide our presentation.
Good evening, Mayor and Council Members. Don Fien, Utility and Development Services Manager. And this is a presentation regarding proposed 2017 water, sewer, and stormwater rate increases, and it is a public hearing. To recap, City selected FCS Group for a utility rate study in October 2011, and we are currently under a contract again with them for a new utility rate study. The first tasks are complete, long-range rate analysis and projections for each utility, and we also completed capital facility charge calculations for each utility. Going into the water utility, here's the pie as to where the money goes. You can see that the big chunks are wholesale water costs, operations and maintenance, and capital. So overall, look at our water utility and the revenues and expenses over the years. We had Public Works Ops Center and loan to the stormwater in 2010. We've had high facility charges during the recovery, and also had a lot of downtown water replacement and infrastructure improvements. And we had revenue bond proceeds come in, and Penn Park Reservoir is currently being constructed. Have a very aggressive capital program for water, over $7.8 million scheduled over the next 7 years. And here's some of the type of projects that need to be addressed. When we look at our 2016 water rate comparisons, Bothell's water rates are in the low middle, and the bottom two in this chart, once again, buy water from Everett, which is considerably cheaper than Bothell. We're proposing a 3.0% rate increase in 2017. The projected rate increase in 2018 would also be 3.0%. The drivers for utilities are an aggressive capital program, including the Penn Park downtown project. Also, water conservation can cause problems as far as revenues. And on the positive side, as far as keeping the rates down, we have had excellent facility charge revenues over the last 4 years. And we've kept our rates exactly about where we were proposing them to be in our 2011 rate study. Sewer utility, this is the pie as far as where the money goes. Sewage treatment's the biggest chunk. The cost at Brightwater is quite high. Also, operations and maintenance and capital are the next two biggest categories. And here's the overall spending for the sewer utility over a 18-year period. Similar to water, the ebbs and flows have been with big projects, high facility charge revenues on the revenue side. And we have also have a very aggressive program with the sewer utility, $8 million worth of projects over 7 years. A lot of water, sewer main replacement, also lift stations that need to be replaced. And here's some of the projects for sewer. We're recommending a 2.0% increase for sewer. Also projecting 2.0% for 2018. Same sort of drivers as for the water utility, aggressive capital program. And on the positive side, good facility charge revenues. And we've kept our rates lower than what we recommend was recommended in the 2011 rate study, the rate increases. Our overall, our rates in sewer are in the high middle category compared to other cities. Stormwater. There's the pie chart. The staff O&M and capital improvements are the biggest chunks of the pie, where the money goes. Likewise with the water and sewer, the downtown revitalization projects, in particular Horse Creek project, $18 million project, are the big cost drivers. On the positive side, we took out a revenue bond. And we've had great facility charge revenues. And very aggressive storm utility capital program as well. Here's some of the projects. The downtown flooding, you can see in December 2007, those projects, many of them have been constructed to alleviate that those kind of problems. And overall, our storm utility rates have gone up. They've gone up considerably since 2012, but considerably less than what we projected based on our rate study. And we're asking for a 2.5% increase in 2017 and 2.5% again in 18 is what the projection is. The rates have been, we've been able to keep down based on several different positive issues that are happening. Collection of storm facility charges. We had a stormwater audit and elimination of credits, which resulted in about $580,000 extra a year. Plus, we started receiving federal, from the feds, their rate, their utility revenues. And here's our storm rate comparisons, and despite probably bigger challenges than the rest of the people of the other jurisdictions here, our rates are below average. So big drivers on storm rates have been the NPDES permit, likewise with all other jurisdictions, and of course, our Horse Creek project. When we look at our combined monthly utility bill, we're about dead in the middle when we compare to other jurisdictions. And if you look at the bottom two, Alderwood and Linwood, which are there, they have lower cost water and lower cost sewage treatment. So if you took those two out, we'd be the low middle category. So staff recommends following rate increases for 2017, supported by the current utility rate study. And that'd be a 3.0% rate increase for water, 2.0% for sewer, and 2.5% for storm. On the capital facility charges that have been done in the current rate study, staff recommends the maximum calculated facility charge rates from that study. Slight increase in the water, bigger increases on the sewer capital facility charge and the citywide storm capital facility charge. With that, staff invites council comments. This is a public hearing. Recommend that you approve the rate increase, and the Public Works fee schedules will include the increases for the capital facility charges, and that will be brought back to you on November 15th.
Thank you, Mr. Fien. As I have a sign-up sheet for the public and nobody signed up, is there anybody in the public that would like to provide comment? And then there was light. Seeing none, is there a motion by council to close the public hearing? Moved by Councilmember Agnew, seconded by Councilmember McNeil to close the public hearing. Is there any discussion on the motion? Councilmember Sandberg?
Are we deciding tonight the utility rate, or are we continuing it to another a date certain? It's planned to have action tonight.
We can vote on motion to approve the, tonight.
Action tonight, okay.
Yeah. Any discussion on the motion to close the public hearing? Okay, place your vote. Passes unanimously. Now we have time for council questions and council deliberation on the rate increases. Is there any questions of Mr. Fien? Councilmember Spivey.
Great, thank you. Thanks, Don. How much of these increases are pass-through increases from like Seattle Water or King County on the sewer, or any of them pass-through increases?
Well, you could say the sewer, as far as what percentage of it is the component is the rate, is the sewage treatment, it's over 60%, goes to Brightwater.
Right, but in these increases,
the actual
60% of that increase is going to Brightwater then?
You could probably, the increase itself, probably, because they're increasing theirs at about 6% every 2 years, so that equates to about 3%. So I would say 60% probably would be a good number for that.
Okay, and then for water, is there a percentage that you could attach to that?
They haven't, this increase? Seattle increased their rates a lot in previous years, but lately they haven't, so I wouldn't attribute much to their of the increase to theirs. So I'd attribute more of it to our capital program, okay. Inflation, because we're only increasing at 3%. Inflation's over 2, so it's inflation's right. Probably the biggest.
So outside of the pass-through cost from Brightwater, most of this is a capital-related increase?
Capital-related and inflationary.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Any other questions, Councilmember Sandberg?
So we did a 2011 rate study, and for that rate study, we projected over time the percentage increases we would need to apply to these rates year after year.
Yes.
And so even though it feels like we're raising and raising and raising, that was what was predicted in the 2011 rate study. And in fact, it seems like we're not having to raise rates as much as predicted.
Right.
Six years ago.
Yes, it's been less for the sewer and storm than what we projected, and just about dead even for the water.
Okay. And so our 2017-18 biennial budget is predicated on increasing these rates. Is that correct?
Yes. Yes, it is.
Okay. And then I noticed for water and stormwater rates, compared to our peers, we're low to medium low. But on sewer, we're high. And I thought the sewer rates were actually calculated based on water usage rate. Essentially, what comes in goes out. So why are our sewer rates, why do we end up in the high category?
Well, I'm not sure if both those issues are related, but so we have a combination. For our residential, for instance, the sewer, we have a base charge, and then we have a volume charge. Most jurisdictions actually for residential still have only a fixed rate set for residential, but we have, 2 years ago, we instituted the a volume charge, but it's a combination of for our sewer rates, it's base and volume.
Okay.
As far as the why our rates are higher than average, I think it's been a very aggressive capital program, and it's been aggressive for a while. We had the ops center. We've renovated two lift stations. We're in the process of renovating a third. We've had a lot of downtown sewer replacement as well.
Okay. And then did you give us a chart on what a typical single-family resident or multifamily resident can expect as a total average monthly increase for
yes.
the three?
Yeah,
did I just miss that?
It's in the packet. It's.
But did you have, you didn't have a slide for that?
No, I didn't have a okay. slide, but it's in your agenda bill. It's $1.14 increase for water per month, $1.42 per month for sewer, and 34 cents per month for storm.
So we're looking at less than $3 per month increase.
Yes.
Okay. For the average single family resident.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Councilmember Freed.
Don.
Yes.
Exhibit 2, page 81. When I go to year 2017, it has the total expenses of 4.6, but then the rate revenues after rate increase of 4.4. What do we do with the deficiency? Like, we have more expenses than we have revenue. What?
I'm sorry. So can you say that again?
Sure. Exhibit 2.
Right.
Column 2017, mm-hmm. the year 2017.
4.4.
I'm used to reading Excel sheets all day. Total expenses, $4.6 million, and then the we're at $4.490. But it says there's a deficiency of $1.8.
Right.
But you're saying, is that $4.4 after the increase, so there's still a deficiency?
Yeah, there isn't one. That's why they have the 4.4. It's the way you read it. It's the 4.4. It does away with the deficiencies.
This increase will do away with the deficiency.
Yes.
It's interesting because it does say to the left, rate revenues after rate increase, but that revenue is less than the expenses still. That's why it seems.
Wait, I'm double check this. Also, I'm not sure how the. So we also, remember we did get a. We got a utility bond too, so I'm not sure if this chart has the utility revenues in there.
Hmm.
I would have to look back on that one.
Okay.
But yeah. we're not in the red.
We are not in the red. You're saying this rate increase perfectly, the 2.5 on stormwater matches our expenses.
We're doing quite well, actually. Yeah.
Does that mean we're making a little money, or
we have extra revenue, but we also have to worry about we have a bond to pay back. We mm-hmm. have bigger capital program ahead of us. So.
Do you have a spreadsheet that shows, like an exhibit 2, that shows what this rate increase does with our expenses and our revenue?
I have a worksheet we use and we review on a monthly basis,
mm-hmm.
I could certainly share that with
you. Yeah, that'd be excellent, because that's ultimately what we're voting on tonight, to raise the rate to show that our expenses are covered by our revenue, and I don't see that here.
Sure, I could.
Okay.
Yeah, I could do that.
Thanks.
Sure.
Can I add one thing very quickly?
Yep.
Okay. Our expenses, if we have a debt service, associated with our expenditures. It might not show in the operating expenditures, it's capital, and then we actually pay it into another fund, which is the 400, which is a combined utility. So his numbers, more than likely, you're just not seeing another part of them, but I do look at them every month. So I do know they're right. So he does have a spreadsheet that will totally back up what he is saying. You'll just see the difference between capital and operating, which in the utility funds is the same fund. With the general fund, they're separate funds. So it gets a little more complex when you're showing operating and you have capital in also. He's showing you right now operating. So thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions? Okay, are we ready for a motion? There's been a motion to move the recommended action, moved by Councilor Agnew, seconded by Deputy Mayor, to adopt the proposed ordinance establishing new user rates for the utility services, including water, sanitary, sewer, and stormwater. Is there any discussion on the motion? Seeing none, go ahead go ahead.
You didn't see my wiggle. I'm going to vote against the motion. I like voting in affirmative for items that I can see the full details on, and I can trust the two people that spoke today, but yet I like seeing for myself the numbers. So if I don't have the full information, I cannot vote in the affirmative to raise these rates. So I'll be voting no.
Any further deliberation on the motion? Seeing none, go ahead and cast your vote. Okay, passes 4-3 with two in the negative and an abstention by Councilmember Spivey. Do you want to speak to your abstention?
Yeah, I agree with Councilmember Freed that needing to see the numbers, just, you know, not that we don't trust you, Don, or anything, but it'd be just doing our due diligence to make have those numbers here up in front. And so that's why I abstained. Just wanted to see those numbers.
Okay, moving on to AB 16-182, plan and code amendments for Nike Hill and South Riverside Drive with affordable housing provisions. I believe the interim city manager would like to take the floor to begin the discussion.
Well, Mr. Mayor, we actually have kind of Johnny Carson line, we've come to a fork in the road, and then when you do take it, tonight you've got a choice on how you want to proceed. And I wanted to talk a little about process before introducing staff. If you decide to start going forward with content, then we'll need to carry that part of the study session this evening. But procedurally, on both Nike Hill and South Riverside, these started in 2014 and 15 as a part of the docket work that was set for the Planning Commission then. They carried into, they actually took longer and carried into the work that was being done this year. These are legislative actions, and what it means is this is within the council's discretion if you want to proceed with this discussion or not. So one of the options relating to both these measures is you could say, look, I don't want to go any further with this. I want to kill it tonight, and you could do that. The second option would be to say, look, we've done the work. Let's get it done, and let's get it approved along with the other items that are in the pipeline for approval in late December this year, in which case we'd need to go to work tonight to start that process. There is a third option, however, and that really is the one that I think has emerged since you had your affordable housing workshop. And we have not developed an affordable housing policy. There is an affordable housing component to both of these measures, but it may or may not really be what you want to do as a part of a larger affordable housing strategy. So that creates a third option, which is to defer the consideration on both these matters into 2017 following the adoption of a city housing, affordable housing policy. So on process tonight, you've got three choices. One, kill it. Two, finish it. Three, carry it over into 2017. So if you can give us some guidance on any of those, if you decide that you do want to proceed with the measure this year, then we will need to go into the rest of the study session tonight in order to make the December deadline. If you decide that you want to kill it, that would take care of it too. We're not recommending that, but the third option is essentially to defer the measure into 2017. So that's the process question, and then we can come back to the substance.
Okay, thank you. So what I'd like to do is just go across to go through the council here, and each of you just weigh in on what the interim city manager just said. So the options are to defer this conversation to 2017. Another option is to just kill it today. And the other option is to move forward with the intent to have this passed this year with the other plan and code amendments that we have docketed. Who would like to go first? Councilman Ragnew.
Well, I don't think we really should kill it. I think we should move it or push it back to 2017 and get an affordable housing policy. I think the city is long overdue for one. I know we tried to move one a few years ago, and it didn't pass, but I think at this point in time, it has a very good chance of passing. So my recommendation would be to push this back to 2017 so we can have an affordable housing policy in place by then.
Councilmember McNeil.
Thank you. I would also like to carry it over. I don't believe killing it is the right answer. And I believe that we can make this and turn this into a great way to get some affordable housing. So I am for carrying it over. Thank you.
To 2017. Okay. Councilmember Sandberg.
I'm in favor of the city working on a comprehensive affordable housing policy next year. I mean, we started this work years ago with our housing strategy plan, and we can certainly look at that again. So that said, I am not in support of moving forward with either of the plan and code amendments. I don't know how much we really want to cover the history, but the Nike Hill rezone was considered as a part of the overall comp plan update of 2015, and there's a process by which plan and code amendments get added to the docket, and this came forward as a property-specific amendment as a part of the overall update. Had it come forward as a docket item, I personally, but I don't know how the rest of council would have voted, would not have supported moving forward with it. So I appreciate Planning Commission and staff's effort on the Nike Hill code amendments, but I don't support them, and for a couple of reasons. First of all, we're talking about increasing the density and intensity right at Meridian and 228th, and in essence, creating a new retail activity center when we haven't even planned for the growth at the Canyon Park Center. And I think that we need to be concentrating our efforts in the Canyon Park Regional Activity Center and not allowing this sprawl out to those neighborhoods. I don't think it's appropriate to have the RAC zone next to a residential area up there on Nike Hill. I don't think it's prudent for us to upzone the DNR property, parcel number 2. The community up there, whether we have a stated goal or not, but the community up there really would like us to purchase active space, recreation space, and we're not going to get there. We're not going to get any closer to that goal if we upzone property and then increase its purchase price for us to buy it. So in a nutshell, that's why I don't support the Nike Hill rezone. I also don't support the South Riverside rezone either. I think it's laudable to try and address affordable housing, but not in one area. We need to have a citywide approach, which is why I would like us to take up this greater citywide approach in 2017. So I am not in support of moving forward on those two issues.
So just so I'm clear, so you want to move them to 2017, or you vote to not move them forward in 2017?
Not move them forward.
Okay. How about this side of the dice? Anybody want to go for it next? Councilmember Spivey.
I'm comfortable with moving this to 2017. Both the top of the hill and East Riverside Drive.
Okay. Councilmember Freed. All right, I'm sorry, Deputy Mayor could go next. Do you want to go?
Okay. Yeah.
Deputy Mayor.
I agree with Councilmember Sandberg. I don't see the point in upzoning anything in the Meridian area when we know we're moving forward with the Canyon Park Regional Growth Center planning phase. To me, that's the bigger area. We should be knowing what we're doing there before we decide to upzone along 228th. So in that respect, I guess I'm gonna kill it on that one. And I've said before during docketing, I'm not interested in doing up zones with affordable housing added on. I want an affordable housing policy in place. So I am happy to look at the South Riverside in 2017. Nice. After we have an affordable housing policy.
He's splitting it up on me. Okay. Councilmember Freed?
Yeah, I'm continuing to look for where South Riverside is mentioned in this tonight.
South Riverside Drive. So if you go,
yeah,
it's very short, so that's why you probably can't find it, but it's page 126. Yeah,
that's why.
Page 126 of the packet. Go ahead.
Okay, I just wanted to add, I also think as far as South Riverside, another reason to wait is that it looks as though King County is doing a study of landslide hazards, and I would like to know what that study says. I live along South Riverside, and I'm very aware of the slide-prone areas on that Norway Hill region or area. So.
Okay. So, from what I'm hearing so far with the comments, it seems like most people are in favor of moving to 2017. I think three people, if I'm counting correctly, maybe not. I'd like to be able to take up at least a couple of these items this year. Certainly would be in favor of doing South Riverside, as well as there is a non-conforming use on the Canyon Ridge condominiums, which might be appropriate to address. Maybe we don't have to move all of these forward, the Army Reserve, the DNR, et cetera, and the Malik property. But if there's a way we could pick up one or two of these in the next month, I wouldn't be opposed to doing that, just because as we push the whole ball forward in 2017 starts to fill up. So if we could choose maybe two of the low-hanging fruit to address, and maybe Riverside Drive is not low-hanging fruit. So my suggestion, I'd like to take it up today. I'm certainly in favor of moving to 2017, but I'm also trying to propose if we could try to grab a couple of these items, like the Canyon Ridge condominiums at the very minimum, and Southeast Riverside Drive, or South Riverside Drive. Is that clear?
Yep. So a couple of things. So I guess I'm the fourth vote here and to move to 2017, and that's where my heart is at. But just in general, for the South Riverside Drive, I don't remember, and I did ask during the joint meeting between the Planning Commission and the City Council to get information about when was it exactly that we asked to look at this whole area, this whole sub area for an upzone, and I still haven't yet to see it in this packet. So when this does come back, I would like to know. We did move, it was in the docketing process to look at the Furman request, which was the area in the, it's on page, what page am I on here? 126 shows the map of the R9600, and we increased the zoning for R7200 for those two specific parcels, and then somehow which I don't know, and I would like the answer to how the conversation expanded to the entire R9600 area there south of South Riverside Drive. And then up on Nike Hill, some of the comments that have been made, I think one of the more important ones is that, and I'm pretty sure the state isn't looking for an up zone so they can make more money off us keeping the DNR land in public domain for a park. So I'm not quite sure why we would propose to upzone it at this time when we're trying to preserve that area. And so is actually the state of Washington. So, and on the affordable housing front, I think we do need to take a, I think this is a nice head nod to affordable housing, but it's just a head nod. And I think it's more important that we actually do make a citywide policy and make a real strategic, take a real strategic approach to affordable housing and make sure that we do it right and we do it looking at the whole city, not just kind of taking an opportunistic opportunity to stuff it into a couple of rezones. So with that, Mr. Blackburn, thanks for coming out tonight. sorry that you had to stay so late. But we'll see you next year on this topic, okay? All right. We couldn't ask for public comment on that. No, okay. So we're going to go into executive session. I do need to have somebody extend the meeting because our executive session will easily run for more than 30 minutes.
Move to extend it to 10:30.
Second. Motion has been made and by Councilmember McNeil, seconded by Councilmember Agnew to extend till 10:30. Any discussion on the motion? Seeing none, place your vote. Passes 5-2 with Councilmember Spivey and Councilmember Freed in the negative. So we're going to, we don't plan to make any, City Attorney, do we plan to come back to the dais and make any decisions on the executive session? Any action?
I don't believe so.
Okay. So we're going to executive session for RCW, pursuant to RCW 4230110(1)(i) with potential litigation and RCW 4230110(i)(c) for real property. And we'll be in there likely until 10:30, and we'll come out and adjourn.